So at the beginning of last year, I had an opportunity to paint a motorcycle helmet for a local motorcycle show called Garage Brewed. I had so much fun doing that that the plan for me was to, of course, do it again this year. And when I did it this year, kind of messed it up. It was a long process, but because it's essentially for charity, I figured I'd go ahead and submit it anyways. But then it got, like, to the point where it wasn't presentable. And I didn't think it would raise much money, so I ended up not submitting it. But I went through all the work of recording the entire process, and doing it. As well as, I'd like to start a new series for myself this year where I work on at least one traditional art piece every month, and I'll talk about that more after I show a bit of the process. At the same time, I wasn't the only one entering something into the show. My dad had been working hard on bringing his, race bike from the 90s back to life and entering it in the show, and I got a bit of footage of that, and I'd love to also share that with you because it was a really cool experience to get to see him talk to people about it and tell stories, and he seemed very proud, and I was also very proud of him. And unlike last time, I think this time I'm just gonna talk about where everything went wrong. This hasn't demotivated me from wanting to do it again. I do want to do it again. In fact, I still have the helmet. I'll show you again at the end. And I plan on sanding everything off and using it to do something else. I was gonna try and redo the same idea. Maybe I still will. But for now, I'm thinking of other things I can do to learn. And overall, this was a massive learning experience for me, and I'm very grateful for the help that I had and the support. Special thanks to my current boss. He let me use his airbrushing studio to do a lot of the painting, and again, thanks to Garage Brewed for the opportunity, and to my parents, friends, everyone else.
So I am in the planning and concept stage of developing this helmet. I thought I would show you guys. I haven't actually gotten the helmet yet, but I wanted to get a head start. Here is what I've been working on so far. I had some other ideas, but I think going with something a little bit more abstract was more fun and maybe a little bit easier to practice airbrushing with. I am using this largely to practice my airbrushing skills. So I decided to choose something eclipse themed. I have a few different concepts. I'll show a turnaround like I did last time in Ride 4. I went ahead and used Ride 4 again for the first part of the concept, but then kind of was like, nah, I think this would look better if I actually like drew it out. So I made a little turnaround for the Biltwell helmets. And yeah, I started with the idea of having like these flames shooting back, and then this, like, I really loved this warp speed concept with all the, like, really bright flashing colors. So I utilized both that and then some, like, neon flames. And then I was like, oh, well, there's an eclipse this year, and that would be really cool to, like, utilize, and also it looks sick. So at first it started out that the flames were on the front, and then to fill the space on the back it was the eclipse, but then I didn't like the design very much. This was also something I did on Ride 4, and I admit it looks a lot cooler on Ride 4 than it does in the concept that I was illustrating. So the later concept became just utilizing the front of the helmet and then making one side the light peeking through as if the eclipse is about to end, and the other side just the, I forget what the technical term is for the light coming off of the shadow of the moon and the sun behind it. What is it called? I don't remember. But yeah, one side is that and the other side is the sun peeking through, and I was able to then utilize both the flames and the warp speed ray type things and the eclipse. I'm still in the process at the moment of like figuring out if I want to fill this space on the back or not, but I'm kind of happy with like the directional lines honestly going on here. I had a silhouette here at one point. Here, I'll just show you. I had a silhouette here to like fill the space, but I don't know, the more I look at it without the silhouette, the more I like it. Again, this is a concept. I might do one more round just to see if I can make it look more closely to what it might actually look like when I airbrush it, but that's the general idea. I really like the idea of utilizing the front of the helmet, so this is where we're at right now with digital concept.
Like every artistic project, it started off with a journey to Michael's. I didn't buy anything crazy, just a white paint primer like the last time, and did about 3 coats, which I'll show you now.
It is a beautiful warm high of 23 degrees, and I'm gonna go get some primer to paint this helmet.
Sanding and priming is definitely the easiest and most optimistic part because you're starting with a fresh, untouched canvas. I had no issues priming. My dad was repainting the tank of his motorcycle, so he had built a temporary paint booth that was a lot more usable than the last time. We had a lot more ventilation and better control over the environment. So I went ahead and did a lot of the priming work in there. After the paint priming process, I moved on to the masking portion of things. Now here's where I'm going to start talking about where I went wrong. So I did myself dirty, and I decided to do a positive mask as opposed to a negative mask. I have masked the helmet for a negative mask. And when I say positive and negative, I mean the part that I'm filling in or covering to avoid getting painted is the interior of the mask. When a negative mask is when you fill in the background space and leave the mask open itself. So I had all these nice sharp lines for a negative mask. Really, what I wasn't thinking about is that when I went to mask this, or when I went to paint, the crappy looking positive mask was what was going to be my lines when I removed the tape. So I'll show you the masking process. I thought everything was going well, I just hadn't thought through the process of how I could have painted. In hindsight, I could have painted with a negative mask, but in my head it would be better to just paint the background first and then work up layer by layer, when I could have done it in reverse. I think in my head at the time it just seemed like that would be more work, and since I was on a time crunch, I was trying to do it as efficiently and fast as possible, and yeah, that's where I came to the decision of doing a positive mask. So I'll show you the masking process. It is kind of satisfying to watch, despite the fact that the mask wasn't great.
So,
unlike last year's helmet, I'm running into the fact that I need to mask some shapes out before I start the actual painting process. YouTube always ends up being my go-to place for tutorials. I've watched quite a few videos already on how to properly mask out some shapes on a curved surface. That's going to be the biggest challenge. I'm working with mainly like the sun rays on one side and then the flames on the other, which are really fine and sharp shapes, and I think that'll be really important to the final execution of the helmet. So that's gonna be the next big step and something I didn't really do last year. This year I actually have access to some really nice equipment and an airbrushing studio, so it will be primarily airbrush paint that I use to complete this helmet. So back to the masking. Okay, I'm sorry. I forgot to start filming when I started masking. So I'll show you what I have so far. I need to clean up the mask. It's not perfect, but that's one side of it. I need to clean up the edges because this is gonna be a positive mask for now. Like, this is gonna be filled in, this area, because I'm gonna do this underside first. But anyways, yeah, this is what I've started so far. This side was pretty easy. I think I might try to realign these rays a bit more. I'm starting on the flames, and from this point on, I'm gonna time lapse it. I totally freaking forgot to start filming the other side, so here's the rest of a time lapse. I'm realizing now that I didn't necessarily have to mask out the moon here, but I had a plan and I stuck with it, so it'll help me keep everything separated in my mind as I go through the layers. But here it is all finished. It's not perfect by any means. Here, I'm gonna give you another view. It is not perfect by any means, but I think I'll be able to accomplish what I want to. The flames are a bit of a mess. Like, it's fine. Airbrushing is a bit of a slower, like, the coverage will be pretty hazy when I do it. You'll see in the video.
And I'm probably just gonna like make sure this is all pressed down properly. I did make sure there were no cracks, but some of it lifts from the thing. Like, this was all pressed down, but it's just slowly lifting. So before I go in and do the coverage, I'll just like slowly press it down. I have one more thing of this to do. Once I get the purple down, there's gonna be this stuff that goes underneath it. So what I'd like to do, you can see it. Hold on, sorry, this is an older illustration. This is the current reference. I put an outline so the flames pop out a bit more, since this is so vibrant in the back. So once I get the purple down, I'm gonna do one more outline around. So when I put this color down, there's a nice, clean, like, purple outline around the flames, and I think that will look super nice in the final product. So, she's ready for painting.
After finishing the masking, it was time to get to airbrushing. When I had talked to my boss about what I was planning to do, he and I both decided it probably would be better if I did one layer of spray paint. For the background, it would waste way less of the airbrush paint, and it would also be less time consuming, and it would be a sturdier and more resilient base. So I decided, okay, let's just do one more base and I'll come back tomorrow and start the airbrushing process. Purple wasn't exactly what I was going for, but I figured I could just do some gradients with the airbrush and still get the desired effect. And here is the airbrushing.
So a quick status update on the helmet. I started airbrushing today. I think it's 5 or 6 days now left until Garage Brewed. And I think everything is going all right. I was a little worried about the masks and how clean they would be. Like, they came out clean, but the shapes are not really the greatest. I'm trying to think of solutions to play with that a bit and see if I can fix it. My one thought is literally just masking it up again. I'm a little freaked out by it. Not freaked out, but more so just like apprehensive to continue. I like to call it a too much gene. I'm just quoting that from Jenna Marbles, but essentially what she meant by that is look at my hand. Not being able to stop, like still wanting to keep adding things on and not knowing when to stop. And I think that's been more of a detriment to my airbrushing than it has been helpful. And I kind of started off on that foot with the helmet. It doesn't look terrible. I think there's things I'm just going to have to fix up, like once I take the rest of the mask off. And I'll do a lot of that either tomorrow or the following day. But I'm just in the phase where I'm like, oh, I don't know if this is gonna turn out like the way I wanted it to. I think I've been thinking about it, and it's like, the one thing I'm not super happy with is the colors in the base, so like the purple. So I'm thinking, like, worst comes to worst, like, I could, like, hand paint again, like, over top of the masks, and it might look, like, really cool and give it, like, the pop that I'm looking for that's kind of absent at the moment. But yeah, it's coming along okay. I'm happy that the masks worked the way they were supposed to. There's just gonna be a little bit of touch-up and stuff before I clear coat it. I'm very excited to paint the flames. I think those are gonna be the most standout, like, cool part of it. It's really satisfying to add the airbrush glow around the fine lines. I think that really makes them pop. So once I get all that done, I feel like it will feel a little bit more complete. I've also decided, thanks to the help of my mom and a few other recommendations from some other artists I've been talking to, I believe I'm going to go ahead and put a sticker on the back alongside the date of the eclipse, just to fill in that space and make everything feel like it's directionally good. Yeah, that's a little helmet update. We are close to the finish line now. I feel a lot more confident now that I've gone and done it. If anything, this has been a really great learning experience, and I am honestly excited to do the next one, and high key want to paint my own, so.
I have a tendency when I do art to just go for it. Despite that just being my nature, it also has been a major detriment to the work that I do every single time. Sometimes I get away with it, other times I don't. And because I just went for it, the airbrushing didn't come out exactly how I'd have liked it to. I had this plan to have these really bright kind of like rays peeking out from behind the flames. But then, in my chaotic way of just starting to work on something, as I usually do, I had kind of completely forgotten that I wanted to do it on that side and ended up doing it on the other side. And when I realized that, I was like, oh, I'll just roll with it. It was looking how I expected it to look in airbrush. As opposed to the digital concept, those light rays were a bit more vibrant, and I knew in airbrush they would have some translucence to them. But I still wasn't able to capture the amount of vibrance that I wanted, and I think that's just because of my lack of skill and patience with the drying of each layer so I could keep layering it up. So, in a panicked fashion, I started to improvise quite a bit, and you'll see that here. Looking back at the progress now, I absolutely and fully regret what I did next, and I think it just put the icing on the cake for me absolutely ruining this helmet. I decided to hand paint. I know, I ruined it. So here's the process of me hand painting, and let me tell you, the entire time I was doing this, I was like, I really messed this up, huh? And I just kept going, and it just kept getting worse, and I was like, ah, oh, this is looking literally worse by the minute. Thank you. in my mind, I was getting this done no matter what, and I was going to find a way to improvise, so I wasn't too worried about it. I just was disappointed that the concept that I had come up with wasn't really appearing in front of me in the way that I had wanted it to. And because the paint layering is so thick, those lines that I had created were there. They weren't lines that I could add to. They were a literal layer of paint versus a layer of paint. So it didn't matter if I layered more paint on top of it, it would just look that way. Unless I did more masking and more priming, which I genuinely didn't have any time for. Don't you love modern technology? Yeah, I just wasn't happy with the line work at all. So I already had something to work with and mess around with and try to make look appealing by my standards that I just wasn't happy with overall. The one thing that was coming out nice, airbrushes are able to give a really beautiful haze around things that make something look very shiny. I knew that would really help the effect of the glare from the sun peeking out, and that part looked great to me. I was satisfied with that. I was satisfied with the main part of the eclipse altogether. It was just everything else coming together that I was like, this looks busy, unorganized, and a mess. I should have just left it as is and worked with what I had, but I was like, no, I'm gonna fix this and maybe I can make it stylistic. Well, on my last helmet, that stylistic approach definitely worked. This one, not so much. I played around with everything under the sun. I was like, ooh, like acrylic Sharpie markers. This could save it. More paint strokes. Make it look more hand-drawn and graffiti. Maybe it will pop out. And this is where everything just came to a complete halt. I messed up the clear coat. Okay, so this is the last day to do anything. Tomorrow is Garage Brewed, and I kind of hate it. I do, I hate it, but the clear coat's dry. My boss was really sweet and went ahead and put another clear coat on it this morning for me, so, and that's dry. But there's some pretty bad drips, and I'm gonna go ahead and try to sand those out and then polish it up, and then it's done. Take all this out, put all the innards back in, etc., etc. So, you know, we'll see what happens. I'm gonna have to get this stuff off. I glued these so I could rip it off, but with all the clear coating and stuff, I don't know. We'll just have to see if it comes off. I don't know if it's going to. Not my favorite thing I've ever done, to be honest. It's nice and shiny, but let's see if I can fix it up at least so it's presentable. When I took the helmet home that morning, in preparation for it to be taken the following morning to Garage Brewed, with the hideous clear coat that I had accomplished, I watched a few tutorials on YouTube on how to sand off slash scrape off drips and then polish them, and that was my plan. It was like, okay, I'm just gonna clean this up as much as possible. And I took off layers of paint. I took off layers of paint doing this and sanding it. Didn't film any of it, but I'll just show you right now. Here it is. And all its ridiculous... Is it gonna focus on it? All of its ridiculous and extremely messy glory. Let me see if I can find a spot where... I hate how the back turned out so much. I was like, I'll use last year's style as a crutch. That was the plan. Since I messed it up, I'll just crutch on last year's style, because that worked out. There you go. See? Isn't that a beautiful, beautiful little tear in the clear coat? There's a few more, too. Oh, there's one. Isn't that great? I'm currently exposing my really unprofessional setup right now. Don't judge me. You can see a drip right there. I can feel the drips right here. There's one successful little scrape right there. I just didn't polish it, but that was one of the few ones that I managed to do it without harming the paint, and then it was just a disaster. Ah, there's some good dripping right there. But yeah, that was another attempt to scrape that I just completely ruined. Anyways, you get the point. It was a massive failure. To give myself some credit, there are parts of it that I like. I just think I would have liked it a lot more had I been able to execute the concept that I was super excited about. But alas, that was not the case. So, to take a positive away from all this, I learned a lot about painting helmets. I learned a lot about what not to do. Maybe I'll try to properly execute this same design. Maybe I'll try something else. Otherwise, I have a blank canvas here. I just have to strip and sand like crazy. Now I'll go back to talking about the most rewarding part of this adventure, which was watching my dad bring his bike back to life. I've talked a bit in some other videos about my dad's history with racing, but I'll touch a little bit more on it now. But he and my mom are one of the biggest reasons that I got into motorcycle racing and am so passionate about the sport now. Not only that, but it's also just brought me closer to them. All that being said, I have a little montage that I'd like to show you guys of my dad with his bike at Garage Brewed.
Team number 7, Red Hot Racing with 168 laps.
I say hello to Howie, say hello to Spike. 'Cause the canals in Camden are filled with bottles tonight. To watch the ripples fade away, to feel the rain on my head, so I could say I've been around the world. And how I wish I was in your apartment tonight, to hear the rain come down, down upon your roof, to see you close beside your bed. I listen to your breath. Instead of being, I've been around the world. Yeah, I've been around, I've been around the world. Yeah, I've been around, I've been around the world.
Like I had also mentioned at the beginning, I decided this year to do a bit of a challenge for myself. I largely consider myself a digital artist, but like many others, for me it all started in a sketchbook. I enjoy digital art because of the portability of it and the ability to work with many imitations of many mediums whenever possible without the mess and bring it with me. It's also inexpensive to constantly buying canvas and supplies. Art supplies are not cheap. It's also really cool to me that digital art is so readily available for whoever wants to pick it up with the new technology that we're seeing. However, in a world where we become more and more attached to these devices, I want to return to the medium that inspired me to start drawing in the first place. I feel like my traditional skills in painting have stayed largely stagnant, and I feel like that's a crime. I really don't want to use these skills and perhaps even utilize them to improve my digital art along the way. And you know, maybe take a much-needed break from the screens every once in a while. All that being said, I am challenging myself this year to complete at least one traditional art piece each month. January was this motorcycle helmet, and February this month is going to be an oil landscape. I have a few other ideas and mediums for each month that I've already kind of planned out so I don't get caught up in thinking of what I'm gonna do as the month approaches, but I'd also like to invite you guys to join me. I plan on documenting all of these, and then it'll be cool to have them at the end of the year to look and see if there's any improvement. I really enjoy oil painting, so I'm excited for this February piece. I'm just really lacking in scenery, so this will be a nice challenge for me. I'm gonna call this the Back to the Basics series. It's simple and to the point and basic. I've gained like 300 or so subscribers since the last video I made, so thank you and welcome. And though I'm not a super frequent uploader here, I'm really active on my Instagrams. I'm also a lot more active on my art YouTube account, or I post a lot more projects there, but I still really enjoy making videos here, and I'm glad that people appreciate them, so thanks for all your kind comments. That being said, I hope you have a great rest of your day. I hope you have a fantastic year ahead of you. I personally am very optimistic for my year, and I'll see you in the next one. Thanks for watching again.